Allahu Akbar.
سميع السمات كبير الشان جليل القدر رفيع الذكر مطاع الأمر جلي البرهان فخيم الاسم غزير العلم وسيع الحلم كثير الغفران جميل الثناء جزيل العطاء مجيب الدعاء عميم الإحسان سريع الحساب شديد العقاب أليم العذاب عزيز السلطان ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له في الخلق والأمر ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله المبعوث إلى الأسود والأحمر المنعوت بشرح الصدر ورفع الذكر وصلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أما بعد فيا أيها الناس وحدوا الله فإن التوحيد رأس الطاعات واتقوا الله فإن التقوى ملاك الحسنات وعليكم بالسنة فإن السنة تهدي إلى الإطاعة ومن أطاع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى وإياكم والبدعة فإن البدعة تهدي إلى المعصية ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل وغوى وعليكم بالصدق فإن الصدق ينجي والكذب يهلك وعليكم بالإحسان فإن الله يحب المحسنين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وقال قال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. My dear brothers and sisters, today's khutbah is about Surah Al-Kahf and its blessing. Surah Al-Kahf is among the earliest surahs that were revealed to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, amongst the surahs like Surah Maryam and Surah Taha and Surah Al-Isra. Al-Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam described them al-itaq al-awwal, amongst the earliest and primary revelations that were given to him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to Ibn Kathir and Tabari, this surah was revealed when the mushrikeen of Mecca wanted to confirm or to test al-Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam if he is a real Nabi or messenger, because they had never any messenger or a prophet. So they went to the Jews of Medina asking them that we have a person who is claiming to be a prophet. Can you give us some information that we can test him or we can quiz him to confirm if he's a truthful person? So the Yahud of Medina told them three questions. They told them that he will answer the first two questions and the third question is a trick question. If he answer the third one, because no one knows the answer to that question, then he's not a prophet. The first two questions were about the young people who sought refuge in the cave and about the powerful king of Zulqarnain that ruled the east and the west. And the tricky question that they asked was about the ruh. And they said that no one knows the answer to this thing except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if he's truthful, he will say that Allah knows the answer to that. So the leaders of Quraysh, they were really happy. Okay, we can test this person now if he's a truthful Nabi. So they came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and put forward these questions to him. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to receive wahi on certain days and time, and it happened to be tomorrow, the next day, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them that tomorrow this time I will give you the answer to it. But he forgot to mention inshaAllah. They went away, the Jibreel alayhi wa sallam did not come with the wahi the next day. To some narrations, Jibreel alayhi salam came with the wahi after 3 days, and according to some other narrations, he came with the wahi after 15 days. But during that time, the mushrikeen of Makkah, they were very happy. Okay, we now know he's unable to answer these questions. He's not a truthful messenger. But Jibreel alayhi salam came with the wahi of Surah Isra and Surah Kahf. Surah Al-Kahf covered the first two questions. The first question was about the young people that sought refuge, and it is in the first section of Surah Al-Kahf. And about Zulqarnain, it is the last section of the Surah Al-Kahf. And the third question about the ruh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the ruh, that Allah knows the knowledge, Allah has the knowledge for that, and we have been given very little knowledge about it, and it is in Surah Isra. Another interesting thing about Surah Kahf is, if you count the words of the Quran, the exact middle, it happens in Surah Kahf, and the exact word which is the middle of the Quran is wal yatalattaf, which means be latif. According to some translation, to be discreet, to be humble. Surah Kahf, the essence of Surah Kahf is It is about trials and tribulations, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always protect you and help you in these trials and tribulations if you seek His help, if you follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Kahf summarizes the essence of the religion Islam. There are four main stories in Surah Al-Kahf, which covers different situation and different trials and tribulation. The first story is about the young men that took shelter in the cave from an oppressive king. The king wanted them not to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they ran away from their city and they went to this cave and sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them that refuge. What this story tells us, that one of the tests that we will be tested on is the persecution on in religion. People will persecute you not to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion of Islam. And how these young people overcome their trial and tribulation, they sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted that refuge to them. The second story is about the gardens of two men, and it is the tribulation about wealth. We will be tested in this world on our wealth. Does this wealth make us arrogant, or does make us humble and be helpful to other people? And to overcome this test and tribulation, we have to remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this wealth, and He can take it away anytime. The third story is of Musa alayhi salam and Khidr alayhi salam. And it is the test of knowledge or false knowledge. Some people, they acquire knowledge and it goes to their head and they become arrogant. And they refuse to learn from other people that they think that they are lower than them in knowledge. But Musa alayhi salam, his maqam, he is the greatest Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he overcome this test of knowledge by learning from Khidr alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him successful in that test. The fourth test and tribulation is to be responsible for other people and to be a ruler or the leader of people. And that's in this story, Dhulqarnain, who was the mightiest king, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him the kingdom from the east to the west. But he overcame this trial by remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Malikul Mulk. He is the ultimate king, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him success in this test because he believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he is the ultimate king. There are sahih ahadith from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that mention the blessing of Surah Kahf, reading Surah Kahf on the day of Friday. Inshallah, I will cover those blessings in my second khutbah. Astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin fastaghfiruh innahu wal ghafur. Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulullah. In my first khutbah, I mentioned that Surah Kahf was revealed when the Quraysh of Mecca wanted to test Rasulullah ﷺ, and they sought the help of Yehud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Kahf and Surah Isra to answer these questions. I also mentioned the theme and the main aim of this surah was that it details different trials and tribulations that all of us will go through throughout our lives. These tribulations are the trial of wealth that can lead to arrogance, the trial of persecution in religion, and the trial of false knowledge, and to be responsible for other people. And how we overcome these trials and tribulation by remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and following the religion of Islam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always give us success in these tests. There are narrations that cover the blessing of Surah Kahf. Abu Darda radiallahu anhu related that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "One who memorized the first 10 verses of Surah Kahf will be secured against the Dajjal." Dajjal is the greatest fitna that a Muslim will face. And if we memorize the first 10 verses of Surah Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us from the fitna of Dajjal. Another version says, "One who commits to his memory the last 10 verses of Surah Kahf will remain immune from the Dajjal." Al-Bara reported, a man was reciting the chapter of Surah Kahf, and there was a horse tied with two ropes at his side. A cloud overshadowed him, and it came nearer and nearer as his horse became frightened of it. He went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the morning and mentioned that even to him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Continue reciting. Verily, this was tranquility, sakina, which came down for the recitation of Qur'an." From Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, who said, "Whoever reads Surah Al-Kahf on the night of Jum'ah will have a light that will stretch between him and Mecca or Kaaba." And in another narration, "Whoever reads Surah Al-Kahf on the day of Jum'ah will have a light that will shine from him from one Friday to the next." It was narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu that Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Whoever reads Surah Al-Kahf on the day of Jum'ah, a light will shine for him from beneath his feet to the clouds of the sky, which will shine for him on the day of resurrection, and he will be forgiven between the two Fridays." Surah Al-Kahf may be read during the night or the day of Jum'ah. The night of Jum'ah starts from the sunset on Thursday, and the day of Jum'ah ends at sunset. Therefore, the time for reading Surah Al-Kahf extends from sunset on Thursday to sunset on Friday. May Allah give us the ability to ponder over this surah, and the ability to memorize this surah, and the ability to read it every Friday. Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله أستعينه وأستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر وأشدهم في أمر الله عمر وأصدقهم حياء عثمان وأقداهم علي وفاتمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة والحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة وحمزة أسد الله وأسد رسوله اللهم اغفر للعباس وولده مغفرة ظاهرة وباطنة لا تغادر ذنبا الله في أصحابي لا تتخذوهم غرضا من بعدي فمن أحبهم فبحبي أحبهم ومن أبغضهم فببغضي أبغضهم وخير أمتي قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون." باقي من السؤال.